That's my daughter, always busy with something, always something to show me. My name is Reuben, and she's my youngest child. I've always heard that having a lot of children keeps a heart from growing old, and while that's probably true, it's hard keeping up with them some days. It's hard to imagine that I was as young as my daughter is now when I first met Jesus. He was a neighbor boy. We played together. And our families went to the same synagogue. It is his story that I want to tell you. But it is my story too. I won't start at the beginning, and I can't tell you all that has happened. But I can tell you this. My life has been changed. And it's not over yet. Jesus loved to play, to run, to race, and to fish. But soon, we began to see signs that he was different from us. For instance, there was a time we made our yearly trip to Jerusalem for the Feast of the Passover, and he nearly scared us all to death by getting lost. Only he wasn't lost at all. When his parents found him, he was sitting in the temple with the teachers. He said that he had to be there. "I must be about my Father's business," he said. My parents wouldn't let me play with him much after that. I guess it didn't seem safe somehow. As the years went on, our lives took separate paths. I married and I started a family. But I kept up with the rumors of Jesus. Soon, I found myself making the trip to Capernaum to see if the stories were true. I couldn't believe the crowds around the house where he was, fighting just to be near him. They said that he healed a paralyzed man who had been lowered down through a hole his friends had made in the roof. but I didn't see it myself. So I followed him to the town of Nain. Oh, the look in his eyes when he saw that mother's sorrow. His first words to her were, "Don't cry." And he touched the funeral carrier. And then he said, "Young man, I say to you, get up." Besides God has the power of life and death. Who indeed? That was the question burning in my heart that day.
Hi, I'm Richard. I grew up right down the street here. I guess I was an okay kid. Now, we didn't do the church thing at my house. Of course, I was expected to behave myself, and I did, for the most part. You see, I was always taught that the most important thing in life was being able to make a living, so I worked very hard at that. I can remember how I struggled through college, and I can remember the day after I graduated. I guess I thought I was going to feel, I don't know, maybe grown up a little, but I didn't. I was just the same guy, but now I was engaged to be married and scared to death. I just couldn't picture myself paying the bills, cleaning out the garage, having people over for a cookout. I mean, this was going to be a stretch. But I gave it a shot. Well, Diane's parents helped us buy a condo, and I finally got a raise, and after the baby was born, I thought for a while we were going to make it. That just postponed our problems. We just couldn't seem to make it work. I sometimes can't believe that I am where I am. Okay job, broken marriage, one-bedroom apartment. It's just me, Diet Coke and the TV. Life seems like it always has, and nothing like I thought it would. I thought it would make sense by now.
There are questions deep inside my heart, and though I look, I never find an answer. I watch as my world falls apart, with no way to put it back together. There must be something I can count on. A purpose must exist. I don't know where I'll be searching, but I know there's something more than this. Now the things I thought would always last have crumbled into dust and disappeared. I face the failures of the past and see there a wall of doubt and fear. I can't find an answer. I don't know where to look. A higher purpose must exist. I know there's more than this.
Speculation continued all over the countryside. Our leaders in the synagogue tried to pin Jesus down about who he was and what he was teaching. But he had no time for pious people, except to show them for what they really were. He used names like blind guides and whitewashed tombs. He spent most of his time with nobodies, homeless types, cripples, or people so openly sinful no devout Jew would be seen close to them. But he wouldn't say what his followers wanted him to say. Was he the Christ? Some said he was Elijah come back from the dead, or one of the other prophets revisiting us. All the prophecies that I had studied seemed to point to Jesus. Could it be that the Messiah was Jesus? I would hear word of him in Bethsaida, Cana, and all sorts of little villages, and when I could, I would try to see him. I heard stories of him touching blind eyes and making them see and feeding thousands of hungry people with just one basket of food. Amazing things. But how could this be? This was Mary and Joseph's son. I had to find an answer. An explanation had to exist, and I was willing to look. I knew there was more to this.
I took one of those career aptitude tests the other day, and it said that I'm best suited to do the job that I'm already doing. This is not good news. You see, I was hoping that it would prove I needed a drastic change in my direction. I'm starting to get burnt out. I have this friend at work who seems to cope a lot better than me. It's not that he doesn't see the problems with the system. They just don't seem to stress him out. So I had to ask him, what was the deal? And he just said, God. And then he asked me if I read the Bible much. Well, anyway, that was my weekend to have Brian, and we did the usual kind of thing. Mostly video games and a lot of pizza. He really likes that double meat, double cheese, double over with indigestion special that they serve downtown. Well, he had kept singing this song that he had learned all weekend. Da-da-da built his house upon the rock. The wise man built his house upon the rock. The wise man built his house upon the rock. Na-na-na-na-na-na-na. I said, where did you learn that? And when will you forget it? All right, wrong thing to say, I know, but it was starting to get on my nerves. Anyway, he said that he had learned it at vacation Bible school. Terrific, the Bible, again. Funny thing, though. I took Brian back over to Diane's house that night, and I knew I hadn't been the right kind of dad I should have been, and now I was going to have to wait 2 weeks to make it right. But as I was laying in bed, I was just looking up at the ceiling, wondering what was really worth believing in. I mean, my formula for making it through life, hard work, marriage, and all that stuff, were no guarantee. I didn't even believe in myself anymore. I felt like my life was the house on the sand in that song. A total disaster.
There must be something I can count on.
I had to find an answer.
A purpose must exist.
An explanation had to exist.
I don't know where I'll be searching.
And I was willing to look.
But I know there's something more than this.
Believe it or not, my friend gave me a Bible the very next day. He just put it in the bed of my pickup truck at lunch. Well, I opened it up that night thinking I'd look up that bit about the house on the sand. Well, I knew the New Testament was the part about Jesus, so I started there. Well, I read it that night, and the next, and well, I sort of got caught up in the life of Jesus. I mean, the way he could see through people, like the woman at the well, and the rich guy who wanted into heaven. Could he have seen through me? Can he see through me?
The truth of
There came a day when I knew the truth. That day changed me forever. I was in the synagogue with my father. He was an elder there. And they brought in a man that I had seen at the gates for years.
You. How is it that you are blind and now you can obviously see?
This man, Jesus, put some mud on my eyes, and then he told me to go wash in the pool of Siloam. I only did what he said, and now I can see.
This man, Jesus, he cannot be from God.
This thing you say he did, he did it on the Sabbath.
That makes him a sinner.
Ah, but how can a sinner do such a miracle? What have you got to say? After all, it was your eyes he healed.
I say he is a prophet.
I don't believe this man was ever blind. This kind of thing just doesn't happen.
Is this your son? Is this the one that was born blind?
Yes, he is my son. And he was born blind. But I don't know how he can see now or who opened his eyes. Why don't you ask him? He's old enough to speak for himself.
The glory for this miracle should go to God. The man you're saying is a prophet is a sinner. We know this.
I don't know if he's a sinner or not. I only know this. I was blind, but now I can see.
What exactly did he do to you? How did he open your eyes?
I've already told you, you did not listen to me. Why is it that you were so interested in the details? Would you like to become his disciples too?
Why, you're a disciple of this man, this Jesus. We are disciples of Moses. We know God spoke to Moses. We don't even know where this Jesus comes from.
Now that is remarkable. Here is a man who healed my blind eyes, and yet you can't even figure out where he came from. God wouldn't listen to an unrighteous man. Have you ever heard of anyone who was born blind, whose eyes were opened? No. I tell you, if this man were not from God, he could do nothing.
You are evil! How dare you lecture us? Get out of the synagogue! You're never allowed in here again!
I followed the beggar that day. I wanted to somehow let him know that I believed what he had told us. I saw Jesus talking to him, and I saw the beggar fall down at his feet. I stood and I stared and I heard Jesus say, I have come to make the blind man see and to show those who think they can see just how blind they really are. I knew in that instance he was talking to me. I was blind, more blind than that beggar had been, and I needed to be healed.
In my world, the moon could never glow, and flowers never bloomed in all their glory. I thought my days would come and go, and darkness would all hide my story. Why would you stop and show your mercy to a beggar in my place? I was lost and blind and lonely, and now I'm looking at your face. True and faithful, true and faithful, Jesus, light of all the world, you're true and faithful from the Father, sent to save.
I will put my faith in you. I will put my trust in you, Jesus, only Son of God, you're true and faithful.
I told my friend that I'd been reading some in the Bible, but I had a few questions. If it's true that this is actually what God is saying to me, well, then there's an answer to all these questions that I have. And that was worth finding out.
As far back as Samuel, every prophet has told us of these very days. All my life, I heard my father reading the words of the Holy Scripture to me in the temple. But now, it had a deeper meaning for me, like the writers were painting a picture of this very time. But that was hundreds of years ago. Yet I was seeing these prophecies fulfilled. But thou, Bethlehem Ephratah, though thou be little among the thousands of Judah, yet out of thee he shall come forth unto me, who is to be ruler in Israel, whose goings forth have been from old, from everlasting. I knew Jesus had been born in Bethlehem, and these scriptures that I had buried in my heart began to reveal themselves to me. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem, behold, thy king cometh forth unto thee. He is just and having salvation, lowly and riding on a donkey. Oh, the people loved him that day. They danced and they sang, and the children waved branches before him. But soon, our leaders used their power to silence him. They had him arrested for blasphemy. He was despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. They accused him of lying and blasphemy. They shouted terrible things at him as he dragged his cross up the road. I remember covering my ears, and I couldn't keep from crying. Nothing they said was true. And they beat him, kicking, spitting on him like he was the worst sort of criminal. Toward the end, he couldn't see for the blood in his eyes, and he could barely walk. In the end, and afflicted. Yet he never opened his mouth. He never spoke the words that would have silenced them. He was brought as a lamb to the slaughter, as a sheep before his shearers.
Yeah. the Son of God became a man. The blood that stained his cross brought us peace with God and fulfilled the Father's loving plan. My sin has been nailed to the cross of my Savior, where Satan has no power, for God has displayed his undeserved favor.
He's taken my sin,
and he has nailed it to the
rescued from its chains. Holy to the Lord, we're blameless in his sight,
standing in his presence
without stain.
Without stain. And my sin has been nailed to the cross of my Savior, Satan has no power, for God has displayed his undeserved favor.
He's taken my sin,
and he has
nailed
it to the cross.
Even through his suffering and shame, Christ bore all my sin alone.
This is all new to me, Jesus. I don't even know how to pray. I seem to have lost my way somehow. I know I'm a sinner, and I know I haven't done a very good job with my life so far. But I truly believe you are who you said you are. Thank you for dying for me. And I'm asking you to be my personal Savior, starting right now.
Oh,
must be. It was His grace, it was His grace, the reason and the way. It was His grace, it was His grace. Why would the Savior take my place? It was His grace.
And then it was over. Jesus was dead. I found myself carried along by the crowd that afternoon. It was preparation day, the day before the Sabbath. And all the people were in a hurry to get back to their homes. But I was wandering the streets feeling absolutely alone. I found the place where Jesus' followers had gathered. It was just a room, a place where we could mourn together. My spirit was crushed. I knew that I too had come to believe in Jesus the Christ. But now He was gone. It was pretty quiet that morning when suddenly three women came into the room. They had been to the tomb. An angel, no body, an empty grave. They spoke to us the awesome truth. Jesus is alive.
Silent, awaiting God's command. to call his son to glory, to sit at his right hand. Angels stood in wonder as he lay there in the grave. Eternity would hunger to hear the Father say, come forth, come forth, step through the open door. Death has been defeated, you can live forevermore. Come forth, come forth, your work on earth is done, my son. Come forth. Early Sunday morning, the hour had finally come. Time for resurrection. Father, call your son. Salvation's work is finished. The price is finally paid. Jesus rose to live forever when he heard his Father say, come forth, come forth, step through the open door. Death has been defeated. You can live forevermore. Come forth, your work on earth is done, my son. Come forth, you can live forevermore. Come forth.
Jesus' blood and righteousness. Righteousness, to be set apart in a positive state of virtue. For us to literally be set apart or set free from this world, it would cost God all that he had, himself. Well, the price he would pay was not with silver or with gold, but with the precious blood of his own son, Jesus Christ. The price for our freedom was expensive. Persecution and trials oftentimes come so that our faith may be proved genuine. God says that we may have grief in all kinds of trials so that our faith may be proved. He said that weeping will endure for a moment, but the hope of joy comes at the resurrection of the morning.
We had prayed and prayed that we would have a child. It seemed like the whole world was praying with us. And when we found that we were expecting, we were just overwhelmed with excitement. I mean, to finally be getting what we wanted was so wonderful, words just couldn't describe it. But then, it happened. The baby came early. There were all these complications. I was so scared. I didn't know what to do
when he called me into his office. I'd watched person after person going in and then coming out jobless. The layoffs and cutbacks were bigger than ever before. I tried to convince myself that it wouldn't happen to me. But then, he said it. I'm sorry, but we found it necessary to eliminate your job. I've never been so afraid
of anything in my life. You go for a routine checkup, And suddenly everybody gets serious and they start talking about biopsies. It's terrifying. So you go through all those tests and you still know nothing. You go home and you wait. You wait for a phone call. It's pretty lonely there where the future is so unsure.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but only lean on Jesus' name.
I trusted God. But I still didn't understand why this was happening. People leave the hospital every day with perfect little babies. Why couldn't that be us? I prayed that God would help us to understand why this was happening to me.
I didn't know. It seemed like my reward for 12 years of faithful service was 90 days severance and a coffee mug. I didn't know what to do other than pray. And that's what I did.
I prayed, and I prayed that God would give me peace about this. And you know, He did, right in the midst of this dark, scary, lonely experience, give me peace and hope.
There's nothing harder than losing a child. But I can honestly say that I feel closer to God now because of our experience than I ever did before. Believe it or not, there's joy in my heart when I think of our time with Emily. She was a precious blessing, if only for a while. And through it all, God was there
to give peace and hope. To tell me that I was going to be all right, and to let me know that He was working everything for my good. When the new job came, and it did, it was just what I needed. And I know that God will never leave my side.
The road ahead will be difficult, but God has promised me that He will never leave me or forsake me, and I'm trusting in His promise.
Echoing voices filled with doom. But now there's light where the dark had grown, and all the grief the world had known has been driven from this place, and the difference is like night and day. After the cross, after the shedding of the blood, there is joy and healing here. There is a compass for the lost after the cross. Yet in my heart there was no peace, for I could never seem to reach the hope my heart was longing for. Life was a constant slamming door, until I glimpsed the hill of grace and saw the look on Mercy's face. And for the first time I believed that when Jesus died, He died for me.
Father sent Jesus to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim freedom for the prisoners, and to give sight to the blind.
When Jesus served as a sacrifice for our sins, He solved the sin problem for good. Not only ours, but the whole world's.
He is the bread of life, and the one who comes to Him will never hunger, and the one who believes in Him will never thirst.
Jesus Christ rescued us from this evil world we're in, by offering Himself as a sacrifice for our sins.
He is the light of the world, and the one who follows Him will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life.
There is only one God, and Jesus is how we get to Him. He offered Himself in exchange for everyone held captive by sin, to set them all free.
He is the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through Jesus.
For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life.
Maybe, like me, you thought you had all the answers until you saw the truth of who Jesus really is. Maybe that happened tonight. Or maybe that's something you've been thinking about for a very long time.
Or maybe your story's like mine, mistakes, wasted time, a lot of painful consequences to bad decisions.
Now is the time to choose the path that is true.
Now it's time to choose the one who is faithful.
Thank you. with me once again and thank the choir for a wonderful presentation tonight. The orchestra, and under the direction of Brother Kerry Schmidt tonight. If you have a Bible tonight, I would invite you to turn to 1 Peter chapter 1 for just a few moments tonight. What a wonderful weekend this has been, and what a great delight to celebrate the resurrected Savior. The Bible says in 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 3, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you." Now, I know many of you are here tonight to hear the music and the presentation, but I want you to take these final moments with me and listen to what God's Word has to say about the resurrection. I heard of a preacher some time back that went into his closet and he found in the closet a shoebox, and he opened it up and found some strange contents. Inside was an egg carton with 5 eggs, and next to the 5 eggs was $10,000 in cash. Soon after he found this, his wife walked into the bedroom, and he stopped her, and he said, "Do you know anything about this box with the 5 eggs and the $10,000? And she said, "Well, yes, dear, as a matter of fact, I do." She said, "When we got married, I decided that after every sermon you preached, if it was a bad sermon, I'd put an egg in this shoebox." And the preacher thought with pride. He said, "Well, wow, after all these years, only 5 eggs in the shoebox. That's not bad." And she said, "But honey," he said, "But honey, what about the $10,000? She said, "Well, every time I got a dozen eggs, I sold them." When we have these presentations and my turn is up to come and say a word, I stand in the back or in the corner somewhere and I pray, "Lord, after a wonderful presentation like that, help me not to lay an egg. Help me to say something that might help everyone to understand the importance of what we're doing here tonight." I just want to touch base with you tonight on this thought. There is hope after the cross. After the cross, there truly is hope. You know, the Bible says in verse number 3 that God has begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 12 says that at that time ye were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. May I say that without Christ there really is no hope. Without a personal hope of the resurrection yourself, there's no reason for living tonight. But you and I can have a living hope. The Bible says that we have a lively hope, a living hope. Luke 24 and verse 5 says, "And as they were afraid and bowed down their faces to the earth, they said unto them, Why seek ye the living among the dead? The angel said to those women who were first to the empty tomb, Why are you seeking the living among the dead? You have a living hope, and his name is Jesus Christ." We have a living hope, and not only do we have a living hope in Jesus, but tonight we have a forgiving hope. For the Bible says in verse number 3 these words, "That he hath begotten us again unto a lively hope, unto the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." We have a lively hope because Jesus Christ, who died and rose again, has promised forgiveness for our sin according to his abundant mercy. The psalmist said in Psalm 86 and verse 5, "For thou, Lord, art good and ready to forgive and plenteous in mercy unto all them that call upon thee." How many of you are glad that the Lord is ready to forgive? I'm thankful tonight for his mercy. I'm thankful that this resurrected Savior has mercy and forgiveness for all who come to him after the cross and see that his blood was shed for their sin. He offers hope and he offers forgiveness. There is hope after the cross. Thank God for that tonight. I want you to notice, secondly, there is help after the cross. Notice what the Bible says, if you would, in verse number 5. It says, who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. God says, I want you to know that I'm going to help you after you accept me as your Savior, after you have received my forgiveness. I'm going to help you. I'm going to keep you. You are going to be kept by my power. I'm thankful tonight that I don't have to keep myself saved. I'm thankful that it's not up to me to find my way into heaven, but that when I trust Christ as my Savior, He keeps me. The Bible says He encourages us with His security. And the Bible says in John 10:27, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. I'm glad that when I accepted Christ as my Savior, April the 5th, 1972, in San Jose, California, that on that day, my soul became secure in the Lord, and that no one, no circumstance can pluck me out of the hand of God. You see, there's not only hope after the cross because of forgiveness, but there is help after the cross because God will never let you go. He will never leave you. He will never forsake you. Furthermore, the Bible says in verse 5, we are kept by the power of God. God has power not only to save you, but God has power to keep you. Paul said in Philippians chapter 3 and verse 10, that I may know Him and the power of His resurrection and the fellowship of His sufferings, being made conformable unto His death. Paul said, I want to know the power of the Lord Jesus Christ in my life. Now tonight, I'm thankful that there is hope after the cross because of the forgiveness of Jesus Christ. I'm thankful that there is help after the cross. I don't have to get through the Christian life on my own. I don't have to try to keep myself saved. I'm glad that by the power of the resurrected Christ, I know that I'm saved and that I will be saved until the day of redemption. He will keep me that way. I heard the story of a little boy named Philip who was born with Down syndrome. And Philip went to Sunday school, and he was about the age of the other third graders. But of course, he was not fully capable of certain mental activities and exercises like the other students were. And because of just the way kids can be, Philip was not readily accepted into his class. It was a transition for him and the other students and so forth. And yet the Sunday school teacher did her best. She tried to make him feel welcome. She tried to help all the kids to understand. And Easter time came around, and so the teacher decided she would use an object lesson to help the boys and girls understand about the life that Christ has brought and about living things. And so she said, now, boys and girls, what we're going to do today, she said, I want every one of you to take one of these little eggs. And she gave them all a little egg like that. And she said, now, we're going to go outside, and we're going to find something that represents new life. She said, I want all of you to go outside on the grass and find something that represents new life, and then put it inside the egg, and then we're going to bring the eggs back into class, put them in a basket, and we're going to open those eggs up and see what we found and what we discovered outside today. And so they went out, and boy, they were running all over the place, and they were having fun like kids do. And then they came back in, and they put the eggs back in the basket, and the children surrounded the basket, and they began to open the eggs one by one, and one little guy caught a butterfly, and another little fella had a worm. And, you know, they were opening up all these things that they had found. They were excited about a leaf and all these different things. And then the teacher opened up one, and when she did, there was nothing inside. And the boys and girls began to kind of laugh and make fun. They said, there's nothing in there. What's wrong? Somebody didn't know what to do. And it was about that time that little Philip said, that's mine. And they said, oh, Philip. They said some names to him. They weren't kind to him. And they said, you're supposed to put something that represents life. And Philip said, but that represents the tomb. And Jesus is alive. And all the boys and girls, they put their heads down. And they felt so bad for what they had said. And in fact, God used that little incident in this true story to kind of put all the hearts of the kids together. And for many years, they were dear friends, and several years later, when God called Philip home to be with him, the true story is told that those children that were there in that third grade class walked by his casket, and they put a little plastic egg on his casket in remembrance of Philip. You see, you don't have to be educated. You don't have to be wealthy. You don't have to be someone with all of the things of this world to understand the power of an empty tomb. The fact of the matter is that the empty tomb represents a Savior who did exactly what he said he would do. He said he would come and he would die, and that he would be buried, and that he would raise up again. And that's why tonight we say there's hope after the cross, because Jesus did die for our sin. And there's help after the cross, because he has power to keep us in his hand until he takes us home to be with him in heaven. And then I want you to see this finally tonight. There is heaven after the cross. There is heaven after the cross. Notice what it says in verse 4. It says, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that fadeth not away. If you have your Bible, read the last part of the verse with me. Ready? Begin. Reserved in heaven for you. God says, now, because of the resurrection, because Jesus is the first fruits of them that slept, because he conquered death and the grave, then everyone who puts their faith in a death-conquering Christ can know that they too will experience eternal life in heaven. There is heaven after the cross, and heaven is an everlastingly pure place. It is a place that the Bible says is incorruptible and undefiled. It never passes away. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 15:52, in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall all be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. And you see, your death and mine will be swallowed up in victory because of the empty tomb. And when we put our faith in Christ, then we know that we will be raised up again to be with him for all eternity. How we thank God for that truth. There is heaven after the cross. And notice, if you will, heaven is everlastingly pure, and heaven is eternally perfect. For the Bible says that it fadeth not away. Have you ever noticed when you buy a new car, it's nice and new and smells so good for a little while? You ever notice when you get maybe a new dress or a new pair of pants or maybe a new house, it's nice and new for a little while and then it starts to fade away? Can you imagine a place where nothing ever fades away? Can you imagine a place where nothing ever wears out, where nothing ever needs to be replaced? Why? Because it is created by God Almighty and it will never fade away. But I've got to show you the best part of this, and we'll be finished tonight. Notice, if you would, in verse 4, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you. Reserved in heaven for you. Oh, there's hope after the cross, and there's help.